y'all just a little something that's happened in my life just recently. My mama passed away a year ago. But I'm going to tell you what, let me tell you. My mama had the strongest faith of anybody I've ever known. And Jesus was her best friend. And I look at some of y'all and I think about my mom. And I just know that she was so ready to get to heaven. And even though I miss her and it was hard for me to lose her, I'm going to tell you right now, I think more about heaven because she's there. And I know, you know, I get so excited thinking about heaven and how we'll all be there one day. So that song, you know, all of these songs about us, bottom line is our, you know, our final home is in heaven.
Amen.
And if we know Jesus as our Savior, then we will all be there. And so, of course, the very best thing we can do is accept Jesus in our heart and know without a doubt that He died for us and that we have accepted Him. And so I pray that for each one of y'all. But anyway, so I'm going to sing a song. If you know it, y'all sing with me. And can I slide this for just a second?
Oh, yeah,
let's do it. Just because I can't get my book.
You go ahead.
Yes. So anyway, y'all sing with me if you know the song, okay?
Okay. I hear the Savior say, "Thy strength indeed is small, child of weakness, watch and pray. Find in me thine all in all. Jesus paid it all. All to Him I owe. Sin has left a crimson stain. He washed me white as snow. And when before the throne I stand in Him complete, Jesus died my soul to save.
Praise God.
My lips shall still repeat, Jesus paid it all.
You know, we are justified. And that means it's as if we have never sinned. Through Jesus, if we have accepted Him, He took care of all of it on the cross, y'all. It's the most awesome thing. And we can, now, if we've accepted Him, we can go and right before Him, talk straight to Him,
Amen.
And then also know without a doubt that we'll be in heaven one day.
Amen.
So, thank you, Jesus.
Thank you, Ms. Barr. Thank you so much for being here. Thank you for that. Thank you for that.
Thank
Praise
you,
God.
Father.
We'll listen to this song, "Till the Storm Passes By."
Still, and to the soul, Christ is mine.
sweet, sweet time of fellowship, Lord. I pray, dear Lord, that you would manifest yourself with the reading of your word, dear Lord, which is held up above all things. We give you praise. We give you honor. We give you glory, Jesus. Holy Spirit, you are welcome in this place. We thank you ahead of time for what you're going to do through this service, dear Lord, that we've gathered because of your name. And you say in your word, where two or three gather, you are in the midst of them. Heavenly Father, we are here because of you. And Lord, we give you praise and honor and glory forevermore. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Till the storm passes by. Amen.
Amen.
I'll tell you, your life brings a lot of storms sometimes. Yeah, I find myself sometimes that... I want you to know this before I get started, that every seat in here, every wheelchair and every chair in here has been prayed for. That I pray for everyone. There's people at the Church of His Vineyard that are praying for you. My wife has been praying for you. So you've already been prayed for when you come in here. When I think about these storms of life, I think about really what we really need is rest. You know, some of us in here, I would go as far to say that we are tired and we're weary. We are heavy laden from laboring. And sometimes when I get the feeling like that, I feel like I don't have any joy in my life. I feel like my joy runs really low. I feel like my joy, my tank is running on empty. And I look, and I find myself sometimes looking in all the wrong places for joy. It's like looking for love in all the wrong places, like that old song. See, I sometimes feel a feeling of emptiness. Could anybody relate with that?
Yeah.
Feeling a little bit empty. Feeling like that this life doesn't have anything for you. There's nothing else left for you. Well, I stopped by the church house this morning to tell you that you have purpose in Jesus Christ. And His faithfulness is your confidence in Him. And I want you to know, don't you ever give up. Don't you give up. The Lord has not given up on you. You still play a major role in His will if you will Him in your life.
Amen. Praise God.
Amen.
You can be as close to Jesus as you want to be. A lot of times we'll just settle with happiness. See, this world will make you happy from time to time, but it won't last. Only the rest that the Lord gives, true rest. We're going to talk about that in Scripture. That's what lasts. Is that true rest that Jesus gives. A lot of times, like I said, I settle with happiness and I go from one little trinket to the next, looking for happiness. But it always leaves me empty. I go from one obsession to the next. My soul is seeking joy. My flesh is seeking happiness. And I'll never obtain joy with carnal things. I'll never obtain it. And neither can you. See, a man or woman is only satisfied with the world and worldly things if they're worldly. But see, we've been called to a higher calling. We're not of this world. We're supposed to be a bright, shining light in this world. And see, a true Christian will never be satisfied until it gets that true rest that Jesus gives. That true joy that's only obtained by abiding in Him. By abiding in Him and keeping His commandments. That's how you receive the joy of Christ, is abiding in Him. And a few weeks back, we were talking about in John chapter 15, verses 1 through 8. We really narrowed in. We put our crosshairs on the word abide. And it was a few weeks ago before that flu broke out. And praise God, that stuff's gone. Praise God for that. There were some answer prayers. But see, Jesus loves us and He doesn't want us to do without. He loves us, yes. He's a God of love, yes. But He also is a God of order. And there's an order of things. And if you want to have His joy and His joy to be filled in you, we'll have to abide in Him and keep His commandments. In order for you to have joy, you'll have to abide in Jesus and keep His commandments. Like I said, do you have joy?
Definitely.
Or sometimes, or maybe you run a little bit on empty. I tell you, a couple weeks ago, I was feeling real empty. I started looking at myself and doing a little self-inventory and finding out that I really wasn't spending as much time with the Lord in private as I need to be. Can I just be honest this morning?
Amen.
See, I'm going to treat you good by giving you the truth. Amen?
Amen.
I'm telling you, like my prayer life needs some help. I'll be the first one to tell you that I really, prayerlessness is sin. We have Jesus Christ died on the cross so that we would be able to have a conduit to His Father. And Jesus Christ will reveal the Father to you through His Spirit, which He has given to you when you confess and believe that Jesus Christ came in the flesh and died on the cross for you. And on the third day He arose. You receive the Spirit of God when you believe that and confess that. Like I said, in John chapter 15, verses 1 through 8, we also talked about, I really narrowed in on abide. I'm going to read a little bit of that. It says, Jesus, this is words in red, chapter 15, verse 1. I'm all over the place. I'm excited, y'all. I'm excited. Hey, listen, I'm going to chase some rabbits, but I'm going to catch one or two also. I'm just so excited to be back in the saddle again, on the road again. I feel free, willy-nilly. I'm a little bit like Willie Nelson. I mean, I'm on the road again. I'm feeling good about this thing. I'm telling you, Jesus says right here in chapter 15, verse 1, I am the true vine, and my Father is the vine dresser. Every branch in me that does not bear fruit, He takes away, and every branch that bears fruit, He prunes that it may bear more fruit. God is going to help you bear fruit. The branch doesn't produce fruit on its own. It has to abide in the vine, and Jesus is the true vine. We also read about in verse 4, it says, abide in me and I in you, as a branch cannot bear fruit of itself unless it abides in the vine. Neither can you unless you abide in me. It goes on to say that we can do nothing. He says, I am the vine and you are the branches. He who abides in me and I in him bears much fruit. I'm going to review this. For without me, Jesus says, we can do nothing. Without Jesus, we can do nothing. He's a God of love and He's a God of order. We cannot do it by ourselves. If we don't have joy, I want you to really do a little bit of self-inventory. I want you to look at yourself as I read these scriptures. And I want you to plant it in your heart, lodge it in your heart, and apply it to your life. This isn't some kind of gig that I do on Sunday mornings. To some people in here, it's going to stick. To some people, it's going to stick. If you want joy, you can have it. The word abide means to accept. We need to abide in the true vine. The word abide means to accept or act in accordance with a decision or recommendation. But here in the scripture from the past couple weeks, it's a rule and it's a biblical truth that we can do nothing apart from Christ. But with Christ, we can have more fruit. And we can also have much fruit, as is written in verse 5. See, you can have also more joy than you have now. We also learned that much fruit is required to glorify the Father. It says it right here in verse 8, by this my Father is glorified, that you bear much fruit, so that you will be my disciples. We need to be discipled. And we can be discipled through His Word. So when we abide in the true vine, Jesus Christ, the Father, God the Father, is glorified. So how do we abide? So you would ask yourself, then how do we abide in the vine? What Jesus tells us is to follow Him. It's to hold to Him, to adhere to the Word, and stand by Jesus even when you're standing alone. It's to uphold the Word above all things. It's to accept Him. It's to go along with and respect and acknowledge Jesus Christ. Am I talking too loud?
No, let her go.
See, Jesus Christ is being, we are to acknowledge that Jesus Christ is being our only source of fruit-bearing capabilities. We cannot bear fruit on our own. It's then, and only then, the Father is glorified. We're not capable of bearing fruit of our own. It's when we abide. Can somebody say abide?
Abide.
Amen. I'm going to get you involved with me now. See, it's when we follow. Amen. And see, we talked about also the week, and it's been a few weeks, and I don't know if you remember it. I barely remember it, but I went over my notes. But it said that we also talked about exercising our faith. And when we do, God is exalted. When you exercise your faith, when you abide in the vine, God the Father is exalted. You'll bear fruit that way. And He's glorified. And see, when God the Father is exalted, then we are then promoted. Promoted to a place. Promoted to a place of peace. Promoted to a place and a position of a heart that this world could never get you. To a place of where God takes you. A place where prayers are answered and He is glorified is when we abide. Somebody say abide this morning.
Abide.
Amen. Goodness gracious, y'all, we are more hyped than I am. See, to me, this describes the most beautiful and intimate story of His love towards us. It's a love story. This scripture, this Bible, is a love letter from God to us. When I read it, it's almost like it's like the scriptures. It's about prayer. It's about communication with God. Jesus Christ didn't only die on the cross for your sins, but He died on the cross so that He could bring you to the Father. You cannot get to the Father except by the Son, Jesus Christ. There is no other way that man will receive salvation except through the Son. He'll take you to a position where prayers are answered and He is glorified. It's when we abide. To me, this describes, like I said, the most intimate and love story and how He's shown His love to us through the finished work on Calvary's cross. He wants the best for us. He's a God of love, but He also is a God of order. Jeremiah said it like this: "The Lord has appeared to of old to me, saying, 'Yes, I have loved you with an everlasting love. Therefore, with loving kindness, I have drawn you.'" He drawn you. See, at some point in our Christian walk, we can all testify what God has told us, that He loves us. At some point in your life, you can testify that Jesus, in the Spirit, has spoke to your heart and He has told you that He loves you. Well, I will speak on behalf of the Holy Spirit and tell you that He loves you, friend. He loves you, sir. He loves you, ma'am. He loves you. And He's demonstrated His love. No greater love than to lay down one's life for His friends. And I have called you friends. His love is not ashamed to be seen with you.
Amen.
He wants the best for us. In Deuteronomy it says, "Therefore know that the Lord your God, He is God, the faithful God, who keeps covenant and mercy for 1,000 generations with those who love Him." He keeps covenant and mercy for 1,000 generations with those who love Him and for those who keep His commandments. See, He's a God of love, but He also is a God of order. It's about keeping His commandments. And He is a God of love. He's a God of order. And His love and His joy is perfected when we abide in Him. Here's that word abide again. At the center of this abiding relationship is the love of God. We're going to be in John chapter 15, verses 9 through 12. But I'm also going to be in Matthew 11. I'm going to jump all over the place. But in John chapter 15, verse 9, it says, "As the Father loved me, I have also loved you. Abide in my love. Stay in my love. If you keep my commandments, you will abide in my love." Let me say that again. If you keep my commandments, you will abide in my love. Just as I have kept my Father's commandments, Jesus said, and I abide in His love. See, these things I have spoken to you, that my joy may remain in you, and that your joy may be full. Let's just for a minute concentrate on verses 9 and verses 10. "As the Father has loved me, I have also loved you. Abide in my love. Adhere to my love. Go along with my love." That's what He's saying. "If you," verse 10, "keep my commandments, you will abide in my Father's love, just as I have kept my Father's commandment and abide in His love." See, these two little words, "if you." If you, if you don't have any joy, if you don't have any peace, we need to ask ourselves, self, are we abiding in God's love? Are we keeping His commandments? And we're going to address those in just a minute. See, if you keep my commandments, you will abide in my love, just as I have kept my Father's commandments and abide in His love. These two little words in verse 10, if you, should tell us who is responsible for cultivating a relationship with God. If you. We have a tendency to gloss over these powerful words because they place the full responsibility upon the reader rather than the writer. Amen?
Amen.
I want amen myself. The responsibility also places the responsibility on us for drawing near to God. It's our responsibility for chasing after Him in His Word. And it's our responsibility of having His joy remain in us. See, we are really responsible for our spiritual state. Now, hold on a minute. I didn't say that we're responsible for having salvation. But see, we can have happiness in this world, but this world will never give you joy. See, we're responsible for having that joy. Because He gives us the recipe right here in John chapter 15. To abide in Him and His joy will remain in us. We are responsible for our spiritual state. See, being joyful is spiritual. This phone makes me happy, but it doesn't make me joyful. This phone makes me happy, but it don't make me joyful. I've got a beautiful house. It makes me happy. But I find out that sometimes I'm just in that house and I'm not happy. I'm living and dwelling in the house and I'm not happy. But see, I can have joy. The joy of the Lord. J-O-Y. It's Jesus, others, and then yourself. We're to put Jesus first, others, and then yourself. We're to lift others up. We're supposed to pull others up so they can see over the wall. So we are responsible for our spiritual state. It's 110 degrees in here. Amen?
It is.
Crank that heat up. We'll catch on fire up here. See, we're responsible for our spiritual state. Amen. That's good. See, the scripture says, if you keep my commandments. So we have to ask ourselves at this point, what are His commandments? Can y'all name one of His commandments?
Yeah.
I bet you could. Okay, here we go. Here's one of them. He said, you shall have no other gods before me.
Yeah.
We know that one. You shall not make for yourself a carved image. Don't worship idols. You shall not take the name of the Lord your God in vain. Okay? Remember the Sabbath and keep it holy.
Yeah.
Amen. How about this one? Honor your father and your mother.
Yeah.
So that your days will be long upon the land which the Lord your God has given you. You shall not murder. You shall not commit adultery. You shall not steal. You shall not bear false witness. You shall not covet your neighbor's things. See, if you keep my commandments, if you keep my commandments, when I read those commandments, I look as if I broke almost all of them. I broke every one of them. See, as an image, when I look at the Ten Commandments, I see myself as a sinner. I'm guilty. You know, mercy is for those that plead guilty. We got a lot of innocent people running around here, you know.
There must be. Because I'm guilty.
See, God has not spoken this truth to us in John chapter 15. Because He's wanting to get something out of us. God hasn't told us this truth to try to get something from us. But He wants to give something to us. Something that we need. See, Jesus knows how empty we will be if we don't keep His commandments. He knows how empty we will be if we don't adhere to Him. He knows how empty we will be if we don't abide in His love and keep His commandments. It's not a bad deal, and it's very reachable. See, His Word says, if you. See, that's all on us. See, usually the one that does the most kicking, is the one that doesn't have any legs stand on. It's a lot of, I want you to get back from this Word. I really want you to listen to this. His Word says, if
you, this is a strong word, this is hard to preach this thing. If you keep my commandments, it's on us, y'all. It's on us. It's on me. It's on you. We got to take full responsibility of His truth. What are you going to do with Jesus? What are you going to do with His truth? He is saying that if we keep His commandments, His love is going to follow us. It's going to hold on to us. It's going to stick to us. See, we will eventually, when we hold and abide to Jesus and keep His commandments, we will be just as close to Jesus as Jesus is close to the Father. We'll be just as close. It says in Matthew 11:27 that all things have been delivered to me, Jesus says, by my Father. And no one knows the Son except the Father. Nor does anyone know the Father except the Son, and the one whom the Son wills to reveal Him. Saying that Jesus will reveal to you the Father. How empty will we become? Jesus is shooting us straight. The Son will reveal the Father to you. There's no way to the Father except for the Son. I was in jail one time with a man. This is back in my past life. I was in a jail cell. But most of y'all that don't know that. That might have been a little shocker for you. But it's true, though. It is true. In my life, when I lived for the devil, I lived for myself. I found myself in a jail cell. And there's a man in there trying to convert me as a Muslim. He was wanting me to become a Muslim. And he said, sir, he said, why do you want to serve the Son when you can serve the Father? I said, man, I do serve the Father through the Son in the Spirit. He said, with Jesus and His 12 disciples, see that man, he came across the way out of the jail cell over there across the way, and he walked over to me. And he told me, he said, well, everything that I thought had come out of 13s, and the number 13 is unlucky. Jesus and His 12 disciples, that's 13. I said, sir, you just walked out of cell number 13. You can go on back. That's a true story. True story. I tell you, God slowed me down in that jail cell. That's when I began to read His Word. I had an old pastor drop the Bible on the floor and kicked it underneath the door, and I started reading His Word. And I read that scripture where it says, draw near to me and I'll draw near to you. See, hey, look, we're sinners. Don't look at me and judge me. I'm telling you, listen, I'm a liberated soul. God's already delivered me. And He's continuing to sanctify me. I've got a whole lot of problems, and drugs and alcohol is not one of them. But He's delivered me from that. He sent Paul to jail. They sent Paul to jail, and it wrongfully. But I'll tell you, I went there on my own accord. I should have been there. But God got a hold of me in that jail. He's long-suffering, and He's very forgiving. He loves us. Amen? Amen. He's a God of love. He also is a God of order. I had to slow down enough to read His Word.
You know what I have to do?
See, He knows how empty we will become. He knows exactly how empty we will become without abiding in His Word. And without abiding in His love and abiding in His commandments and keeping His commandments. Verse 11 in John chapter 15 says, these things I have spoken to you that my joy may remain in you and that your joy may be full. If you're running empty this morning and you don't feel real joyful, I understand. I get it. We're all in a fight. We're all in a spiritual fight. But the Lord tells us that if we abide in His love and keep His commandments, that His joy will remain in us and that our joy will be full. See, how He knows how empty we will become without the joy that He provides. As empty as this world wants you to be. This world and Satan wants you to be empty. As empty as Satan wants you to be. If he can't kill you on the outside, he'll try to steal and kill what's on the inside. He wants to take your joy from you. And He does this by distracting us and tempting us with worldly things. And things that are empty themselves. Little carnal trinkets that cannot fill this void that's only made to be filled with the Lord, the joy of the Lord. See, we must be purified and filled with the joy of the Lord. Jesus tells us in Matthew 11, verse 28, he says, come to me, all you who are labor and heavy laden, and I will give you rest. Uh-huh. See, God says, come to me. This is words in red. Jesus says, come to me, all you who labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. This word rest in the Greek translation means purification. So we actually can say, come to me, all you who labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you purification. I will purify you, Jesus says. We must be purified to be filled with the joy of the Lord. Amen. And we're purified by abiding in His love and keeping His commandments, and His joy will remain in you, and your joy will be full. I'm giving you a recipe for joy this morning. Amen?
Amen.
Well, I'm like the view was written a long time ago. See, I'm just relaying the message.
That's great.
That your joy may be filled full. Are you filled with joy? Or are you running on empty? See, most of the time, we never slow down enough to examine why we are in the shape that we're in. We never slow down enough to examine why we are in the shape that we're in. Time keeps on going. The clock, the tick, and the top. You know, they'll roll us down the aisle, and time will still have a tick and a top. We're running life and fast forward. I find myself running around. I got so much to do, so much to do. We have to examine why we're in the shape that we're in. I would like to ask you, when you leave this place today, when you leave church, you go back to your room, I want you to go into your secret place. And I want you to shut the door behind you and pull a chair up in front of you and sit in it. And ask yourself, where is my joy? Where has my joy went? Are you full of the joy of the Lord? Or are you running on empty?
Running on empty.
Are you keeping His commandments then? So your joy may be full? Are you saved? Are you saved? Are you saved? Are you sanctified? Are you sanctified?
I'm working on it.
Amen. Me too. Is your joy full? Is your joy filled? Have you abided in His love? Are you keeping His commandments?
Yeah.
See, this is the commandment. Are you keeping His commandment? In verse 12 of John chapter 15, He said, this is His commandment. These things I have spoken to you, that my joy may remain in you, and that your joy may be full. Verse 12. This is what I want to narrow in on right here. If you don't get anything from my rambling and carrying on, I want you to get this. Jesus says, this is my commandment, that you love one another as I have loved you. You know, sometimes we can get real close to one another in here, and we get aggravated with our brothers and sisters in Christ. And somebody's in our spot that shouldn't be. Somebody got my spot. I really wanted to be at that table right there, but so-and-so, Miss Hannigan got pulled up in the chair. And I really wanted that spot close so I could hear the music. Sometimes we need to let go of trivial things. His commandment says that we are to love one another as I have loved you. Who is your brothers and sisters in Christ? Here. Love one another. It's real tight and hot here. We should love one another. Keep His commandment. This is the commandment that Jesus was talking about. Abide in His love and keep His commandments, that your joy may be filled. Love one another as I have loved you. That's His commandment. Love. That's love.
The right kind of love.
Amen. He is a God of what?
The right
kind. He's a God of love. He also is what? A God of order. If you abide in His love, if you keep His commandments, if you love one another, as I have loved you, Jesus said, your joy will be filled. We have no excuse to not be joyful somebody in here needs some rest. Maybe somebody in here needs purification. What did Jesus say? He said, come to me, all you who labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. I will give you purification. He'll purify you. Have you been majoring on the minor? Has somebody been in your place? Has it been real hard to love your brother or sister? You know how much love Jesus loved you? This much.
Pure love.
He loved you this much.
Amen, brother.
It's because of love.
100%.
He says, come to me. He says, come to me. Come to the Lord. Jeremiah says it best right here. We're almost about to end this thing. Jeremiah said it best right here. He says, thus says the Lord, stand in the ways and see and ask for the old paths. I like that. I kind of like that. I like that old time religion.
Amen.
He says, ask for the old paths.
Amen.
Where the good way is.
Oh yeah.
He said, stand in the ways and see and ask for the old paths where the good way is. And walk in it. Walk in it. You walk in it. I walk in it. Then you will find rest for your souls. Let's say it like this. Stand in the ways and see and ask for the old paths where the good way is. And walk in it and you will find purification for your soul. You will find joy for your soul. See, your soul is seeking joy. Your flesh seeking happiness. It always leaves you empty. The joy of the Lord will remain in you if we keep His commandments. The joy of the Lord will remain in you if you love your brother and sister. There should be evidence that you're a Christian. You should demonstrate your love like Christ has demonstrated His love for you. Give yourself up for the mission. Give yourself up for the will. You still have a place in God's plans. Don't you ever give up. Don't you ever give up. Matthew 11, 29 says this. This is good right here. It says, take my yoke upon you and learn from me. Y'all ready to learn from Jesus?
Yes.
Yeah.
I tell you what, I'm a lifelong learner. God's still teaching me that I don't have anything figured out. Let me tell you, I started up a fire. So I told y'all I burned a wood stove at the house, right? Well, I cut down a bunch of trees on the land. I get a kick out of that. That I bought some land where I cut the wood off of. That wood heats us and keeps us warm during the wintertime. I love that. That self-sufficient life like that. I'm kind of got an old soul. You know, I love sitting around the wood stove and hearing that thing pop, you know, and crack. I just love it. Ain't nothing like that. You know, the thing is, you can't really get a happy medium. You'll burn up. You'll be sweating. You sweat when you chop it down. You sweat when you stack it. Then you sweat when you burn it. But I wind up with a bunch of limbs, and my yard's a mess. So I had to get up all those limbs. I had to clean up my yard, you see. And I got to get all those limbs up, and I dump them off on my burn pile. I got a big burn pile. I'm a little country, amen. I got a burn barrel, too. Now, you might be from Greer if you got a burn barrel. Amen. My wife wants to get rid of that thing. It looks bad. I just love sitting inside that burn barrel. Burn my trash, you know, what can burn. You can put your tin cans in a grocery sack, you know. And you burn all your things in a burn. Don't put no can in my burn barrel. You know what I'm saying? That's my grandpa. Don't put a tin bowl in there either. But you know, I get up all these sticks and I gather them up and I put them on my fire pit. On my fire pile. I got to go fire. And I went and got me some diesel fuel. Now, I went and dumped all that diesel fuel on top of that. I lit it up. There was a big old blaze. It just went up into heaven. Just, whoo, then it burnt back down. And it was gone. It was gone. That's sort of like to me, the way life is. It was a big fire. I was real happy for a minute there. It just sizzled on down because my wood was wet. My wood wasn't seasoned. My wood wasn't seasoned. And so what I had to do the next day, I came back out there and I started up a little bitty fire at the bottom. Instead of trying to burn it all at one time, I just did one thing right. And I'm asking you this morning to make just a little fire in your heart. Just a little fire in your heart. And a little fire will get us a big fire. And I'm telling you, put a log on the fire for Jesus. Because I want to tell you, when I got that little fire going yesterday, it began to form up some coals at the bottom of that burn pile. And when I got those coals, it got hotter. Oh, hallelujah. And it got bigger. And it got hotter. And there was coals that burned, and you could have put a green piece of wood on there and it burned right up. It's because I started a little fire. I'm trying to start a little fire in your heart this morning. Amen. This right, I should preach on this right here. But I'll tell you what, I'm just trying to start a little fire in your heart this morning. Put a log on your fire for Jesus. Don't try to burn the whole thing down at one time. Just do a little thing. Just do something different. Just do something different. Be faithful with the small things.
Yeah.
Take my yoke upon you and learn from me, Jesus said. Just start a little fire, okay?
Yeah.
For I am gentle and lowly in heart. This is our Savior saying this. And you will find rest for your souls. Oh, man. Take my yoke upon you and learn from me, Jesus said. He's a God of love and he's a God of order. Abide in me, so that my love will abide in you. Keep my commandments, so my joy may remain in you, and your joy may be full. Take my yoke upon you and learn from me, Jesus said, for I am gentle and lowly in heart, and you will find rest for your souls. My brothers and sisters in Christ, you will find purification for your souls. My yoke is easy, and my burden is light.
Praise God.
Praise God. I thank you for listening this morning.
You ain't gonna quit, are you? You just started.
Well, I tell you what. Let's have a prayer. Every head bowed and every eye closed. Let's look to the Lord. Let's get serious. If this sermon spoke to your heart, and you've been running empty on your joy, if your tank's been running empty, and you have felt like there's nothing else left for you in this world, I want you to know that God still loves you. He still loves you, and you still have purpose. I don't want you to ever give up. And if you want your joy to be filled, start loving your brother. Start loving your sister. Start keeping his commandments so that his love will abide in you. I want you to abide in the Son so you can have the Father, and then the Son will reveal the Father to you through the Spirit. You want to go to heaven? If you're wondering if you're saved or not, and you're not sure, you're not 100% sure, I want you to say this prayer. And it's more than just a prayer, but if you really mean it, God knows it. Dear Heavenly Father, Jesus, please come into my heart. I'm a sinner, and I don't have that joy, but I want that joy, Lord. Please give me that joy. Please give me that joy, Jesus. I believe that you died, dear Lord, on the cross for my sins, that you were buried in a borrowed tomb, and on the third day you arose, Jesus. I believe that you live today. I receive this gift. This gift of eternal life, I receive this gift of love that you've given us. Dear Heavenly Father, please come into my life and take over so I'll start abiding in you and you'll abide in me. And we'll be one together. Dear Heavenly Father, I need this. Please save me. In Jesus' name, amen.
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 Praise the Lord.
Praise God.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Let's listen to this song right here. He's a good, good Father. Amen.
Amen.
Yeah. Excellent.
Oh, I've heard a thousand stories of what they say.
Anybody need special prayer? Anybody needs to be praying? Anybody needs some prayer? Raise your hand. Or you can help me pray for some of these business. Father Jesus, I thank you so much for this path, dear Lord. Bless her, dear Lord. Come in and go, dear Lord.
this little fire in our life, dear Lord. Just a little fire. Hallelujah. Because you're a good, good Father.
It's who you are.
It's who you are. You love by doing that.
Emotion.
all for coming out. We love you. We'll be praying for you. We really love you guys. Thank you so much. If you didn't get across this week, we'll bring a handful next week. I want you to take this word and start a little fire in your life. Amen?
Amen.
There's encouragement inside His word. There's freedom inside His word. And there's forgiveness underneath His blood. Have you been washed in the blood of Jesus? Have you been washed? Is there purification for your soul? There's joy for you. An everlasting love. May your joy be filled full throughout this week. I look forward to worshiping with you next week. We love you. Be in prayer.
Amen. Amen. Thank you, brother.